Girl, you'll be a woman soon.
In this video, we're going to continue on with our experiment to see how quickly we can take a total noob, my girlfriend, and mold her into a proficient poker player. As was mentioned in the last video, our approach is going to be to acclimate her to GTO incrementally through the use of two tools, Drive HUD 2 to diagnose leaks in our game, and GTO Check to find remedies for those leaks. Now, some of you have asked what I mean by incremental learning of GTO. Well, historically, the way people have learned GTO in the past was basically they were given solutions to hand and told to memorize them. However, Nash equilibrium strategies are so complex that it's impossible for any human to memorize the precise strategy for even a single hand, let alone all spots. So the way that we advocate learn GTO is through a gradual process which focuses on specifically addressing a player's individual leaks. All players have their own unique strategies, the personal framework that they use to make decisions at the felt. For example, some people may c-bet range on all dry king-high flops, or they may check raise with all of their combo draws, or randomize bluffing with their weakest hands. Generally speaking, the unique strategies of the best players in the world are closer to GTO, and the unique strategies of the worst players in the world are further away from GTO. This is indisputable. Of course, there are outliers and exceptions, which some have pointed to as anecdotal proof that non-GTO-based approaches are superior, but a word of caution for those that seek the path of white magic. It's a murky, treacherous journey filled with landmines and pitfalls, where many will lose their way and end up wandering aimlessly in a desert of exploitation. In contrast, since game theory is not based on amorphous things like intuition or feelings, and instead is based on math, it is objectively learnable, and the path is much more clearly defined. And so our goal with Ariel will be to ultimately move her from here to here, but of course this won't happen overnight. Instead, it'll be a gradual process. We will be making small, incremental modifications to her unique strategy by picking up concepts, principles, and tricks from GTO solutions that address her specific leaks instead of trying to get her to just memorize full solutions. The key is that we will only incorporate specific elements of GTO into her game in such a way where her strategy will still be simple enough to be executed with confidence and clarity. We don't want to overload her with all the complexities and nuances of Nash equilibrium solutions at once, because that would be overwhelming. For example, in our last video, we used a HUD to identify a couple leaks in Ariel's game, one being that she was c-betting too often. So we reviewed a few hands she c-bet where the solver was instead doing a lot of checking, and from that we developed a very basic game plan, which is not GTO per se, but it does incorporate certain GTO elements. And we're going to continue this gradual process of identifying leaks using a HUD and adding refinements from solver solutions to hone her strategy over time. Ariel has been playing with this new game plan for the last few days, and although we only have a tiny sample size, from our updated graph, it seems that we may have at least been able to slow some of the hemorrhaging with just these few adjustments. We see that her preflop numbers are starting to trend in the right direction, which hopefully should continue as she gets more practice, and we also see some improvements in her flop c-bet percentage as well. In this video, we're going to focus specifically on flop defense. Here we see that when facing a c-bet, she folds 54% of the time and check raises 2% of the time. When we compare this to Pluribus' numbers, we see that the bot defends the flop at a significantly higher percentage, only folding around 45% of the time and check raising around 9% of the time. So this definitely appears to be a leak that needs to be addressed. As we did in the last video, we're going to hone in on this leak by filtering her hands. So we're going to go to the filter screen and then filter for hands where she faced a continuation bet and there were only two players on the flop. Now, although generally you'll be losing big blinds in these spots, we see that Ariel is getting absolutely punished here with a massive losing rate. So what we're going to do is we are going to cherry pick a few of these hands and run them through GTO check to see if we can get any insights from the solver to help shore up her flop defense. In this first hand, we're going to look at villain open 2.5x on button, and Ariel called in the big blind with ace queen. The flop was jack 5-7, Ariel checked, villain c-bet around 47%, and Ariel folded. When we take a look at the solver solution, we see that ace queen off is a pure call. As you may recall, one of the rules in Ariel's simplified game plan was that she would not be doing any floating. But given that we've identified from Drive HUD 2 that Ariel is overfolding the flop, to help bolster her defense, we're going to refine this rule a bit to reclassify ace king, ace queen, and overcards with a backdoor flush draw as medium strength hands, as they have some showdown potential as well as the ability to draw to stronger hands on later streets. And we can test this new hypothesis against the solution to objectively measure its viability. We already know that ace queen was calling in full, but what about overs with a backdoor flush draw? Well, let's first filter for Ariel's ace and king highs that have a backdoor flush draw. And we see that in this specific case, there are two combos that fit within this category with two overs, ace queen and king queen. And if we isolate these hands, we see that they're basically calling 100% of the time. So far, so good. Now to reinforce this hypothesis, let's take a look at another hand. In this one, villain raised in the hijack and Ariel cold called in the cutoff with king 9 suited, which she now knows she shouldn't be doing. And then the flop came 6-4-5, villain c-bet around 3/4 pot, and Ariel folded. However, when we take a look at the solver solution and isolate all ace and king highs with the backdoor flush draw, we see that these hands are calling 71% of the time, and we also see that the EV regret for calling this bucket is 0%. Now, I know that some in the past have raised questions regarding this concept of EV regret, correctly pointing out that it is not a GTO metric. However, given that no human being can replicate GTO perfectly, especially for beginners, it not only makes sense, but it's an absolute requirement that we use heuristics and approximations when attempting to incorporate Nash equilibrium concepts into our game. And the most logical way to do this, in my opinion, as I've asserted on many occasions in the past, is through the use of bucketing, while focusing on EV loss as the objective measuring stick to evaluate our simplifications. Remember, as I said at the top, our goal is to incrementally learn GTO by only slightly modifying our unique strategy so that we can still execute it with confidence and clarity. Directing a total beginner to implement these mixed strategies perfectly is a complete non-starter. So instead, we will refine Ariel's strategy using simplifications that are guardrailed by EV loss. So now that we've built into Ariel's game a few additional categories of hands to call c-bets with, let's address her meager raising percentage. In this hand, villain opened in the cutoff and Ariel called in the big blind with ace 7 of diamonds. The flop was 10-3-9 with 2 diamonds. The villain c-bet 60% and Ariel called. Now according to the solver, this call is perfectly fine. But we do see that it actually prefers raising most of the time, and raising is one thing that we did not explicitly address in her game plan. So let's see if we can create a reasonable raising range that gives her some balance, but at the same time is simple enough to be implemented by a total beginner. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to filter for all of her unmade hands, and then we're going to isolate for the combos that also have a flush draw. As we can see, the raising frequencies are a bit all over the place. Generally, it appears that the solver prefers raising with the stronger flush draws compared to the weaker ones, but then again, ace-jack is basically not raising at all. And will often be the case that the solver's raising and betting strategy with its draws will be a function of a multitude of factors, including players' ranges, bet sizes, SPR, card removal, equity, and the number of draws and value combos available in Hero's range. But of course, considering all of these factors is too tall of an order for a total beginner. So what we're going to do is use a very simplified approach. If we take a look at the EV regrets for calling and raising, we see that both options are very low. And even when we add in her open-ended straight draws, which are also strong enough to defend against this bet, the EV regrets for both actions remain relatively low, and this will often be the case across many different flops. So the heuristic we're going to employ for Ariel's draws that are strong enough to defend is that she's simply going to raise half of them and call half of them, and she's going to determine which option to choose by using a randomizer. As many of you know, randomization is an essential part of utilizing GTO strategies because of how mixed the strategies are. Basically, mixing occurs when there is a group of similar hands that cannot be played all in the same way without losing balance. For example, let's say we wanted to simplify by just check raising 100% of all unmade draws. Well, when we isolate gut shots in this bucket, we see that unmade draws make up 23% of the big blind's range, which would result in way too much raising. On the other hand, we can't simply call all draws either because that would result in not enough raising. So we address this dilemma through mixing using a randomizer. This keeps various draws in both our passive and aggressive defending lines, allowing us to make very strong hands in various branches of the game tree, keeping us somewhat balanced. And speaking of balance, if we want to bluff, we also need value combos. So let's now take a look at how the solver constructs its value raising range. If we filter for Ariel's strongest hands, her sets, and two pairs, again we see that the strategy is mixed, but the EV regret for raising all of these hands is very low. So to balance Ariel's raising range, she's just going to raise 100% of all of her nuttiest hands. Now, what constitutes her nuttiest hands, of course, depends on the context, particularly the board. But generally, the idea is that she will raise with hands that are strong enough to play for stacks, assuming a clean runout. On dry boards, this will sometimes be strong pairs with top kicker and better. However, on wetter boards, her strongest hands may only be straights or flushes. The general idea is we want our raising range to be significantly stronger than our opponent's value betting range, such that our raise can be called by plenty of weaker value combos. In this case, we see that Ariel's sets and two pairs are ahead of the vast majority of Villain's range, and Villain should be only folding around 30% of its range against this raise, so he has plenty of weaker value hands to call with, such as overpairs and 10x. In this next hand, Villain raised in the small blind and Ariel defended the big blind with King 5 of Hearts. The flop was Ace 3 Deuce, Villain c-bet around third pot, and Ariel called. So let's again test out our new hypothesis by isolating Ariel's unmade hands with a draw, and in this case, the only draws available are gut shots. As was the case with the last hand, the solver is doing a significant amount of mixing, but the mix is a bit different, as this time it appears that the solver prefers raising with the weaker gut shots and calling with the stronger gut shots, which have more showdown value blind versus blind. But Ariel is not going to worry about any of that, she's just going to randomize and raise half the time and call half the time, and we see from the EV regrets that either play will not result in a significant EV loss. Now, what about her value raising range? Well, unlike the last hand, we have possible straights in the ranges, and when we isolate them and add in her sets as well, we see that these hands are mostly raising with an EV regret raise of 0.1% of the pot. As for Ariel's two pairs, although these hands are still ahead of most of Villain's range and raising them doesn't result in a huge EV loss, checking them appears to be the preferred play, both in terms of overall frequency and EV regret. So in a nutshell, our plan of action to shore up Ariel's flop defense is as follows. When facing smaller bets, she's going to add into her calling range Ace-King, Ace-Queen, and overs with backdoor flush draws, and she's going to construct a check-raising range built around her strongest value combos and randomly mix in her draws. Now obviously, this is a very simplified heuristic and won't be perfect GTO. But instead of trying to implement a one-size-fits-all approach, we have to keep in mind the skill and experience level of the student. Just the other day, I had to explain to Ariel what top pair and king high meant, so trying to teach her the precise Nash equilibrium strategy in any capacity would be an exercise in futility. So we're just going to continue this same process of identifying the unique leaks in our game using Dry Flood 2 and finding tailored remedies for these leaks using GTO check solutions with the goal of incrementally improving her game bit by bit. So that's the video for today. Thanks for watching, and until next time, stay balanced. The boy's no good. Well, I find